Madam Speaker, I rise to present before this august house the statement of estimate receipts and expenditure for the year 2014-15 for railways. As I stand in this temple of democracy, I owe this opportunity to the people of this country who have elected us to represent them and to shape their destiny. I am grateful to Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji for having reposed his faith in me and entrusting this huge responsibility of leading Indian Railways. I promise to fulfill this responsibility and make every endeavor not only to lead Indian Railways but also aid in building a vibrant India under the dynamic leadership of Shri Narendra Modi ji. I believe in the saying, honesty is the first chapter in the book of wisdom. I do follow this. It gives me immense pleasure to present my maiden railway budget. Indian Railways, being the nation's prime mover, is the structure and soul of Indian economy. It echoes rhymes and rhythm in the hearts of every citizen of this country, from Baramulla in the north to Kanyakumari in the south, and from Oka in the west to Lake Pani in the east. Madam Speaker, we all know that Indian Railways cut across all barriers of regions, classes and creed, and it is microcosm of India on the move. From a man on the streets of Bangalore to fish vendors in Kolkata, from the hustle and bustle at Nizamuddin station, everywhere you find a citizen of this country rushing to connect with the Indian Railways. Madam Speaker, though I am hardly a month old in the office, I am flooded with requests and suggestions for new trains, new railway lines, and better services from the honorable members of the parliament, from my colleagues in the government, from the states, from the stakeholders, from the organizations, and from people of all walks of life. I know that everybody feels that there is a solution for challenges which Indian Railways face. I too thought so when I was an outsider to this system, and before I was exposed to the intricacies and complexities of the vast organization. Now I am overwhelmed with the enormity of my responsibility in fulfilling these expectations as a Minister of Railways. Madam Speaker, it reminds me of Kautilya's words, Praja Sukhe Sukham Rajya Prajanam Cha Hite Hitam Natma Priyam Hitam Rajya Prajanam Tu Priyam Hitam. This translates, in the happiness of the people lies the ruler's happiness. Their welfare is his welfare. What pleases him, the ruler shall not consider good, but whatever pleases his people, the ruler shall consider good. Indian Railways runs about 12,500 trains to carry over 23 million passengers per day, connecting more than 7,000 stations spread across the subcontinent. It is equivalent to moving the entire population of Australia. We run more than 7,400 freight trains carrying about 3 million tons of freight every day. Madam Speaker, having achieved this distinction of entering the select club of railways of China, Russia and USA in carrying more than 1 billion tons of freight, I now target to become the largest freight carrier in the world. Madam Speaker, as you know, apart from serving the passengers, the Indian Railways carries coal, it carries steel, it carries cement, it carries salt, it carries food grains and fodder, and it also carries milk. Thus, Indian Railways practically carries everything and anything and everything, and it never says no to a thing if it fits to the wagons. Most importantly, we are the backbone of supply chain of the defense establishment and play a crucial role in the security of the nation. Madam Speaker, while we carry 23 million passengers a day, there are still large number of people who have not set a foot on the train. We carry over 1 billion tons of freight a year, connecting ports and mines to industrial clusters, but still there are vast tracts of hinterland waiting for rail connectivity. Though freight business has grown steadily over years, the Indian Railways carry only 31% of the total freight carried in the country by all modes. These are the challenges we have to face. Madam Speaker, an organization of this magnitude, vested with various responsibilities, is expected to earn like a commercial enterprises but serve like a welfare organization. These two objectives are like two rails of a railway track which though travel together but never meet. So far, Indian railways have managed to do a tightrope walking by balancing these twin conflicting objectives. Social service obligations rose from 9.4% of gross traffic receipts in 2000-2001 to 16.6% in 2010-11. In 2012-13, such obligations stood over ₹20,000 crore. Total investment, which is the plan outlay under budgetary resources in the same year, was ₹35,241 crore. Madam Speaker, Indian Railways would continue to fulfill its social obligations, but sustaining these objectives beyond a point is not possible without compromising on efficiency, safety of train operations. We have a total track length of 1.16 lakh kilometers, around 63,000 coaches, more than 2.4 lakh wagons, and 13 lakh employees. This calls for an expenditure on fuel, salary and pension, track and coach maintenance, and more importantly, on safety works. This takes up most of our earnings from gross traffic receipts. In the year 2013-14, gross traffic receipts were ₹1,39,558 crore, and total working expense were ₹1,30,321 crore, which works out an operating ratio almost all 94%. This, Madam Speaker, implies that we spend 94 paisa out of every rupee earned, leaving 6 paisa only as surplus. This surplus, apart from being meagre, is continuously on decline due to non-revision of fare. The surplus, after paying obligatory dividend and lease charges, was ₹11,754 crore in 2007-08 and is estimated to ₹602 crore in the current financial year. Madam Speaker, this meagre surplus so generated is required to finance the plan outlay for safety, capacity expansion, infrastructure, improving passenger services and amenities. Funds to the tune of about 5 lakh crore, that is around ₹50,000 crore per year for next 10 years, are required for ongoing projects alone. This leaves a huge gap between what is available as surplus and what is needed. While prudent efforts should have been made to address this gap, the tariff policy adopted so far lacked a rational approach. Passenger fares were kept lower than costs, thus causing loss in the passenger train operations. This loss kept on increasing from 10 paisa per passenger per kilometre in 2000-2001 to 23 paisa in 2012-13. On the other hand, freight rates were revised periodically and kept high in order to compensate the losses sustained in the passenger sector, resulting in freight traffic getting diverted consistently. Also, the share of railways in freight traffic came down consistently in last 30 years. Madam Speaker, it is important to note the decline in the share of total freight tariff is revenue foregone. Madam Speaker, I have spoken about how revenue was frittered away. Now let me touch upon how the investments are misdirected. There has been focus on sanctioning projects rather than completing them. In the last 30 years, as many as 676 projects were sanctioned worth ₹1,57,883 crore. Of this, only 317 projects could be completed and 359 projects remain to be completed, which will now require as much as 1,82,000 crore. In the last 10 years, 99 new line projects worth ₹60,000 crores were sanctioned, out of which only one project is complete till date. In fact, there are four projects that are as old as 30 years, but are still not complete for one reason or another. The more projects we add, the thinner we spread our resources and longer it takes to complete them. I am sure if this trend is allowed to continue, many more thousands of crores will get spent yielding hardly any returns. Madam Speaker, having spoken about never-ending projects of Indian Railways, let me throw some light on the kind of priority accorded in choosing projects. It is investment in doubling and tripling to decongest over-utilized network, which brings money to railways. On the other hand, construction of new lines most of the times do not even meet the operational cost. In the last 10 years, Indian Railways made an investment over rupees 41,000 crore in laying 3,700 kilometers of new lines. On the other hand, it spent only about rupees 18,400 crore for doubling of 5,050 kilometers, though it was priority over the new lines. I would like to read a comment on Indian Railways by someone which I chanced upon. I did not understand it till I learnt about the fact I talked about so far. It is unheard of a business that has a monopoly, that has nearly 100 crore customers base, that has 100% sale on advance payment, but still starved of funds. This, Madam Speaker, is the story of Indian Railways so far. Railways serving the social obligation would not have been an issue. However, in the name of social viability, the chosen projects were populist in nature, bringing hardly any revenue to the railways. On the whole, neither the projects brought returns to the railways nor social responsibility was met in full for many years. This mismanagement and apathy brought railways into a situation of severe funds crunch for many years, which is a result of the decade of golden dilemma, the dilemma of choosing between commercial viability and social viability. Madam Speaker, I am sure my esteemed predecessors were aware of this precarious situation, but they, however, fell prey of nasha of claps on the house when they announced their projects. Madam Speaker, I also can get claps from this august house by announcing many new projects, but that would be rendering injustice to the struggling organization. I would like to take steps throughout the year by setting the things in order. This state of affairs of Indian Railways needs immediate course correction. Among the many corrective steps that I have planned out, fare revision was one, which was a tough, but it was a necessary decision. Madam Speaker, as they say, yatta dagre vishamisha pariname amrutopamam. The medicine appears as bitter in the beginning, but likes a nectar at the end. This fare revision will bring Indian Railways an additional revenue of rupees 8,000 crore. However, need nine more crore to complete the diamond quadrilateral network and about rupees 60,000 crore for introducing one bullet train alone. But Madam Speaker, I can depend only on hiking fare and burden the public to mobilize these funds. I want to read it again. Please hear me for a while. If you don't have the patience to hear my budget, what you can do? Madam Speaker, can I depend only on hiking fare and burden the public to mobilize these funds? This is unrealistic. Thus, I need to explore the alternative sources of resource mobilization. The first source is leveraging railway PSU resources. Madam Speaker, railway PSUs have done very well and are financially sound. I propose to bring investable surplus funds of railway PSUs in the infrastructure projects of railways, which can generate attractive returns for PSUs. The second source is private investment in railway infrastructure, domestic as well as foreign. It is domestic as well as foreign direct investment. The growth of railway sector depends heavily on availability of funds for investment in railway infrastructure. Internal revenue resources and government funding are insufficient to meet the requirement. Hence, Ministry of Railways is seeking the cabinet approval to allow FDI in railway sector, except railway operations. The third source is public-private partnership. There has been a lot of talk about public-private partnership for raising resources. Railways, being a capital incentive sector, have not been successful so far in raising substantial resource through PPP route. Madam Speaker, it is my endeavor to pursue this in right earnestness. It is our target that bulk of our future projects will be financed through PPP mode, including the high-speed rail, which requires huge investments. Madam Speaker, apart from mobilizing resources, I also need to strategically manage other aspects of railway planning and administration. To meet this end, I propose the following initiatives. Near plan holiday approach, prioritizing and setting timelines for completion of ongoing projects, devising a mechanism for raising funds for rail infrastructure, decision support system for project implementation, strategic partnership and transparency in procurements, aggressive indigenization of imported products, adopting safety standards, matching international practice, and setting up a simulation center to study cause of accidents. Encouraging development of wagon leasing market. Now, Madam Speaker, let me place before this August House the financial performance of 2013-14. Since presentation of interim budget and passing of the vote on account on February last, financial positions has undergone a change. Madam Speaker, railway carried 1,050.18 million tons of freight. Goods earnings were short of target by rupees 94 crore. Originating passengers also were less by 46 million over revised target, and passenger earnings were short by rupees 968 crore over the revised budget. Overall, though the gross traffic receipts grew by 12.8% to reach rupees 1,39,558 crore, it was short of revised target by rupees 942 crore. On the other hand, ordinary working expenses stood as rupees 97,571 crore, which was in excess by rupees 511 crore. Appropriation to pension fund has to be stepped up to match the actual outgo. As a result, instead of ending the year with a surplus of rupees 7,943 crore, the surplus was actually rupees 3,783 crore, that is a shortfall of rupees 4,160 crore. This is after fulfilling the dividend commitment of rupees 8,010 crore. The internal resource generation for plan in 2013-14 was rupees 11,710 crore, as against revised target of rupees 14,496 crore. This is short by rupees 2,786 crore. In 2013-14, there was a decline in traffic growth as compared to the revised projects. Expenditure, however, shot up and was more than what was estimated. The operating ratio deteriorated by 2.7% over the revised target to touch 93.5% by the end of 2013-14 fiscal. So far, our plan expenditure for 2013-14 is concerned, it fell short of revised target of rupees 59,359 crore, mainly due to non-materialization of PPP targets. Madam Speaker, now I proceed to present before the House the budget estimates for the year 2014-15. Anticipating a healthier growth of economy, I hope to achieve total receipts of rupees 1,64,374 crore, and I would peg total expenditure at 1,49,176 crore. I anticipate freight traffic growth of 4.9%, amounting to 1,101.25 million ton, an increment of 51.07 million ton over 2013-14 based on trends in the first 2 months. I also anticipate a small growth in the passenger traffic over 2013-14. Earnings from freight traffic are estimated at rupees 1,05,770 crore, and from passenger traffic rupees 44,645 crore. The fare revision, which came into effect from 25-6-2014, has provided railways a much-needed respite, however little it may be. As I have considered the request of the suburban passengers for revision of monthly season tickets, the revenue foregone on this account would be around rupees 610 crore. Here I may point out the periodic revision in passenger fare and freight rates as approved by this August House will be linked to revision in fuel prices in order to insulate the railway revenues from fuel cost escalation. Madam Speaker, out of total expenditure, the ordinary working expenses have been proposed at ₹1,12,649 crore, which is ₹15,078 crore higher than 2013-14. This has been necessitated by fuel price hike and increase in staff costs. Pension outgo in 2013-14 had grown by about 16%. Keeping the same trend, provision for pension is kept at ₹28,850 crore. Madam Speaker, I thank the Finance Minister for extending additional budgetary support of ₹1,100 crore as capital and ₹273 crore as railway share from DCLSS for important road safety works. Largely owing to this measure and to the additional resource mobilization efforts, I propose to increase the plan outlay under budgetary sources to ₹47,650 crore, which is higher by ₹9,383 crores in 2013-14. A large part of this higher plan outlay goes to safety-related works, which is also a high priority of our government. As I have increased the internal resource component of the plan, I propose to scale down market borrowings through Indian Railway Finance Corporation to ₹11,790 crore. Madam Speaker, time overruns and consequential cost escalations in completion of most of the railway projects have been a chronic worry of railways for years. I propose to provide maximum financial outlays to projects targeted for completion in the current year itself, keeping in mind the priorities and safety. I have ensured adequate allocation for 30 priority works for their timely progress. It is my concern to allocate the available resources to high priority areas like safety, cleanliness, passenger amenities, and capacity augmentation. Madam Speaker, let me now spell out details of the focus areas of this budget. I will first touch upon steps proposed for improving passenger amenities. Indian Railways envisaged to provide foot overbridges, escalators, and lift at all major stations through PPP route. Indian Railways should make earnest attempt this year to provide sufficient water supply, platform shelters, and toilets at all the railway stations. Passenger services through private entity. Indian Railways proposed to extend service of battery-operated cars to facilitate differently abled and senior citizens to reach any platform comfortably at all major stations. We propose to involve individuals, NGOs, trusts, charitable institutions, corporates, etc. to provide passenger amenities. As Indian Railways serve a lot of business travellers who spend substantial time in travel, in order to add best value to their time, I propose to provide workstations in select trains on payment basis. A pilot project will be launched by this year. Online booking facilities of railway retiring room will be extended to all stations during the course of the year. Madam Speaker, extending passenger-friendly services is the motto of Indian Railways. In this direction, I am expanding the scope of online booking. People can book a train, people can book a coach, people can book a berth, and people can book a seat in the chair car. Catering, Madam Speaker, catering on railways has been a major issue of concern for a long. In order to improve the quality, hygiene of onboard catering services and to provide variety, I propose to introduce pre-cooked, ready-to-eat meals of reputed brands in phased manner. Further, I sincerely desire to bring perceptible improvements in the catering services by introducing quality assurance mechanism through third-party audit by NABCB certified agencies. In addition to the third-party audit, a system of collecting feedback through IVRS mechanism from the travelling passengers on the quality of food served will be launched shortly. If the service is not to the standard set, especially in hygiene and the taste, severe action will be taken, will be initiated against the vendors, including cancellation of the contractors. Indian Railways also proposed to set up food courts at major stations to provide the option of ordering regional cuisine by while on board through emails, SMS, and smartphones, etc. A pilot project will be started shortly between New Delhi Amritsar and New Delhi Jammu Tawi sections. Madam Speaker, cleanliness is next to godliness, said Mahatma Gandhiji, our beloved father of the nation. Madam, I am aware of the sorry state of affairs of cleanliness in the trains and stations. Railways have been attaching high priority on cleanliness, but it has always been a challenge to maintain the acceptable level of cleanliness owing to the sheer number of passengers handled at the stations. Madam Speaker, I have substantially increased the budget allocation for cleanliness in the current year, which is 40% increase over the previous year. I propose to outsource cleaning activities at 50 major stations to professional agencies and to set up a separate housekeeping wing to have focused attention and exclusive responsibility of maintaining cleanliness and sanitation at stations. Madam Speaker, a corpus fund for upkeep will be set up stations in order to provide enough financial resources to the officers who are entrusted with the responsibility. CCTVs at stations will be used to monitor cleanliness activities. All India level helpline number will be printed on the back of the tickets. System of periodic third-party inspections will be introduced. Further, biotoilets will be increased in sufficient number in trains in order to mitigate the problem of direct discharge of human waste on the tracks and platform aprons at stations. Onboard housekeeping services, currently operational in 400 trains, has received good feedback from passengers. This will be extended to all the important trains. I also propose to increase mechanized laundries in order to improve quality of the bedrolls provided in AC coaches. We will introduce on an experimental basis RO drinking water units at stations and in trains. Reputed and willing NGOs, charitable institutions and corporate houses will be encouraged to adopt and maintain stations for better cleanliness and upkeep. Madam Speaker, safety of passengers is of paramount importance for Indian Railways. It is estimated that over 40,000 crore would be needed to be invested in track renewals, elimination of unmanned level crossing, and construction of road underbridge and road over bridges. I have received a lot of requests from various states for construction of road over bridges and road underbridges. I am making a provision of ₹1,785 crore for road underbridges and road over bridges in this budget. I would request the concerned state governments to expedite their proposals and pass on their share of cost. I have decided to introduce a system of speedy clearances based on first-come, first-served basis. We intend to standardize designs and make this available online. Delegation of powers shall be done so power of sanctioning is decentralized. Indian Railways have 30,348 level crossings, out of which 11,563 are unmanned. Each unmanned level crossing is being examined in detail, and depending upon the site condition, action will be taken to eliminate it by suitable modality. Indian Railways propose to use modern vehicle-borne ultrasonic flaw detection system to detect rail and weld fractures. In addition, ultrasonic broken rail detection system will also be tried at two locations as a pilot project. In order to improve the safety of travelling passengers, I propose to bring in technology for automatic closing of doors before the station, before start of train, both in mainline and in suburban coaches. A pilot project will be limited, number of trains will be taken up. In order to strengthen the security of trains at stations, 17,000 RPF constables have been recruited and shall be shortly available for deployment. We also propose to recruit 4,000 women RPF constables in order to ensure security of ladies travelling alone. Special instructions are being issued for their safety in each class of travel. With the introduction of women RPF constables, coaches meant for ladies will be escorted. RPF escorting teams in trains will be provided mobile phones so that passengers can contact them when in distress. Security helpline will be augmented. We will explore the possibility of building boundary walls around the stations through PPP mode. Madam Speaker, I foresee a huge untapped potential in the field of domestic tourism in our country. We plan to take up ecotourism and education tourism in northeastern states. Special pilgrimage centers like Devi Circuit, Jyotirling Circuit, Jain Circuit, Christian Circuit, Sufi Circuit, Sikh Circuit, Buddhist Circuit, and famous temple circuit have been identified. I propose to introduce specially packaged trains for these circuits. Private participation in this area will also be encouraged. On tourist trains will run, one tourist train will run from Gadag, Pandrapur via Bagalkot, Bijapur and Solapur, covering the pilgrim and tourist places of Karnataka and Maharashtra. Another such train will start from Rameshwaram, covering pilgrim and tourist places like Bengaluru, Chennai, Ayodhya, Varanasi and Haridwar. I also plan to run a special train featuring life and work of Swami Vivekananda to inculcate good moral values, propagate the teachings of Swami Vivekananda. Madam Speaker, railway reservation system will be revamped into next generation e-ticketing system. Ticket booking through mobile phones and through post offices will be popularized. We will improve the system capabilities in e-ticketing to support 7,200 tickets per minute as against 2,000 tickets per minute and allow 1,20,000 simultaneous users at any point in time. Facility of coin-operated automatic ticket vending machines will be experimented. Efforts will also be made to provide facility of buying platform tickets and unreserved tickets over internet. Parking cum platform combo ticket will be launched to facilitate the passengers and to save their time. Madam Speaker, at this moment, the Railway Board, due to overlapping roles of policy formulation and implementation, has become unwieldy. Therefore, I propose to separate these two functions by restructuring the ministry. Indian Railways has 13.1 lakh staff, most of whom work on the cutting edge level of providing rail services. It is my duty that they are taken care by providing adequate facilities. In this direction, I am initiating the following. Presently, an amount of rupees 500 per capita is contributed towards staff benefit fund. I propose to increase this amount to rupees 800 per capita. I propose to announce a special scheme for the meritorious wards of railway persons for their outstanding performance in academics and sports. The hospital management information system will be used to integrate all health units, divisional hospitals and central hospitals, as also our empaneled hospitals. Examine feasibility of providing air conditioning in loco cabins and provide AC in running rooms. I am contemplating on setting up of a railway university for both technical and non-technical subjects. We will tie up with technical institutions for introducing railway-oriented subject for graduation and skill development. In the meantime, staff at the ground level will be sent for short-duration courses of technical and non-technical nature, involving locally available technical institutions. The exposure for specialized areas like high-speed, heavy haul operations, etc., will be undertaken for all level of staff and officers at appropriate institutions in India and abroad. I think you are all pleased by my budget.
Yes, yes.
So you are telling that it should be taken some time.
CP, we
It is. Please hear me. It is the wish and dream of every citizen that India runs a bullet train as early as possible. Madam Speaker, Indian Railway is on its way to fulfill that long cherished dream. I propose bullet trains by starting off with an early identified Mumbai-Ahmedabad sector where a number of studies have been done. Madam Speaker, it was the vision of our great... Please hear me. No, sir. It is... Madam Speaker... Madam Speaker, it was the vision of our great leader, Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee Ji, that gave India the golden quadrangular road network. Today, under the leadership of Shri Narendra Modi Ji, Honorable Prime Minister, we are embarking on an ambitious plan to have a diamond quadrilateral network of high-speed rail connecting major metros, growth centers of the country. A provision of rupees 100 crore has been made in this budget for high-speed project, for taking further steps. Madam Speaker, while budget trains would require completely new infrastructure, high speed for existing trains will be achieved by upgrading the present network. Hence, an effort will be made to increase the speed of trains to 160 to 200 km per hour in select sectors so as to significantly reduce travel time between major cities. The identified sectors are Delhi-Agra, Delhi-Chandigarh, Delhi-Kanpur, Nagpur-Bilaspur, Mysore-Bangalore-Chennai, Goa-Mumbai, Mumbai-Ahmedabad, Chennai-Hyderabad and Nagpur-Secunderabad. Madam Speaker, Please hear me. You didn't do it. Why you are fighting at us? Madam Speaker, as you know, the IT revolution has permeated in all spheres of human life. It has not only made life comfortable, but also made the service delivery efficient and the onus now. It is on us to make governance transparent and accountable using IT solutions. Yes. Though Indian Railways has taken up computerization in a large way, all the efforts have not been synergized. Hence, the desired results are not achieved. Need of the hour is to bring in a total change in the work culture and delivery of railway services by going in far large-scale integrated computerization of major functions of railway, Indian Railways. Madam Speaker, Indian Railways is also going for a computer-assisted enterprise resource planning solution so that synergy is brought in. To begin with, following initiatives will be taken up. Moving towards paperless office of Indian Railways within 5 years. Next generation ticket reservation system. Wi-Fi services in all A1 and A category stations and select trains. Real-time tracking of trains and rolling stock. Mobile-based wake-up call system for passengers. Mobile-based destination arrival alert. Station navigation information system. Extension of dual display fare repeaters at all ticket counters through PPP. Digital reservation charts at stations. Extension of computerized parcel management system. Extension of logistics support to various e-commerce companies by providing designated pickup centers at identified stations. Providing education to children of railway staff at remote locations through RailTel OFC network. Indian Railways hold vast land assets, the records of which need to be digitized and GSA mapped for better management and usage. This would help railways in protecting the lands as well as leveraging it for raising resources. The resource mobilizing using land assets will be explored through private participation in setting up railway-related business on railway lands as well as for commercial development. Madam Speaker, in an effort to keep pace with development of modern world, railways have to adopt and reinvent itself constantly. Challenges of tomorrow cannot be met by the tools of yesterday. In this direction, I propose to set up an innovations incubation center. This center will harness the ideas generated from the staff of Indian Railways and convert them into practical solutions to increase efficiency of the system. Such innovations, which result in cost saving as well as revenue generation, will be suitably rewarded. As part of this exercise, I also propose to set up summer internships for undergraduates of engineering and management studies. The students can intern at any of the various units of railways, that is, divisions, PSUs, and production units. With large backlog of sanctioned projects, funding continues to be the biggest challenge for railways, while private investment and customer funding for some port connectivity projects and few other power sector projects has started, much more needs to happen if infrastructure creation has to keep pace with the requirement. We will interact with the industry and take further steps to attract investment under PPP throughout BOT and annuity routes. About 8 to 10 capacity augmentation projects on congested routes will be identified for this purpose. Zonal railways will be suitably empowered to finalize and execute such projects. Madam Speaker, Indian Railways has taken up port connectivity on priority through PPP mode of funding tandem with Sagarmala project of port development. Railways will facilitate connectivity to the new and upcoming ports through private participation. So far, in principle, approval has been granted for building rail connectivity to ports of Jaigarh, Dighi, Rewas, Hazira, Tuna, Dholera and Astranga under participative model policy of Indian Railways, amounting to a total over ₹40,000 crore. Railways will speed up construction of critical coal connectivity lines in Tori Shupur area, Jharsuguda Sardega area, and Raigarh Mand area. This will bring nearly 100 million tons of incremental traffic to railways and will also facilitate faster transport of coal powerhouses. Madam Speaker, we will take up development of identified stations to international standards with modern facilities and passenger amenities on the lines of newly developed airports through PPP mode. Initially, Indian Railways will take up at least 10 major stations of metro cities and import junctions with state-of-the-art facilities, leveraging land and airspace in and around the stations. Madam Speaker, Indian Railways propose to modernize logistic operations by setting up logistic parks that provide for warehousing, packaging, labeling, distribution, door-to-door delivery, and consignment tracking. In order to achieve better efficiency, mechanization of loading and unloading will be given top priority. In the existing pattern of traffic movement, Indian Railways, more than 33% of the freight trains over the system run empty, since return traffic at existing freight rates are not forthcoming. In order to garner additional revenue, I propose to launch a pilot project whereby automatic rebate from the computerized voice system will be made available to customers offering returning traffic. This would help reduce the empty flows on Indian Railway system, apart from garnering additional revenue. While there has been an incremental growth in our parcel earning, I see a huge untapped potential in this segment, which needs to be tapped by Indian Railways. At present, the parcel business is hindering the movement of passengers on platforms. It is therefore necessary that parcel traffic is segregated to separate terminals where requisite facilities for storage and handling of parcels are made available to the customers, and parcel consignments move the dedicated parcel trains running on fixed timetable. Accordingly, a scheme of private participation in parcel movement will be launched shortly, whereby procurement of parcel rakes by private parties will be facilitated. A new design of parcel vans with better tare-to-payload being finalized. It is expected that putting these measures in place, we would be able to substantially improve our earnings from the parcel segment. To develop network of freight terminals, policy of private freight terminals on PPP mode on being further refined. I propose to give a boost to railway movement of fruits and vegetables in partnership with Central Railside Warehousing Corporation by providing requisite facilities of temperature controlled storages at 10 locations in the first phase. The aggregation and distribution of railway terminal points shall be organized by CRWC. I hope this would, apart from avoiding national wastage of these products, help producers of fruits and vegetables in different parts of the country in getting better prices for their produce. Madam Speaker, Indian Railways proposed to facilitate transportation of milk through rail by providing special milk tankers, trains, in association with National Dairy Development Board and Amul. Madam, it is proposed to harness solar energy by utilizing rooftop space of railway stations, railway buildings and land through the PPP mode, apart from our own sources. Indian Railways will start using biodiesel up to 5% of the total fuel consumption in diesel locomotives. This will save precious foreign exchange substantially. Railways have been suffering heavily because of time overrun and cost overrun due to poor project management. In order to overcome delays in the project execution, I propose to set up a project formulation and management group at the level of Railway Board consisting of professionals, similarly to expedite the projects at the ground level, a project monitoring and coordination group consisting of officials of state government, railways and professionals will be set up. Simplification of procedures and easy access to the information bring transparency and trust in public. Transparency in administration, execution of projects and procurement will be given top priority. Strategic procurement policies will be adopted to make the procurement process transparent and most efficient. E-procurement will be made compulsory for procurements worth rupees 25 lakh and more above. For the convenience of the state governments and other stakeholders, the status of ongoing projects will be made available online. Madam Speaker, I am happy to inform the House that there are 23 projects underway in the Northeast, of which 11 are national projects. I propose to allocate substantially higher funds for these projects compared to the previous year. In 2014-15, an outlay of rupees 5,116 crore is earmarked for the project of Northeast. This is 54% jump over the allocations in the previous year. With higher allocations and by close monitoring of works in this region, I hope that Dudhnei, Mendipathar, New Line, Lumdang, Badarpur, Silchar Gate Conversion, Harmuti, Murkong Selek, and Balipur, Balakpong sections will be soon get commissioned. These measures will also give a boost to the state capital connectivity projects in the region. Madam Speaker, this August House are already aware of the Udhampur-Katra railway link has recently been dedicated to the nation by the Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji, fulfilling the long cherished dream of Atal Bihari Vajpayee and millions of pilgrims across the country. We have also tied up with the Jammu and Kashmir. You hear the next sentence? You hear the next sentence?
Yes, Mr. Minister.
We have also tied up with the government of Jammu and Kashmir for bridging Udhampur-Banihar portion by bus so that passengers can reach Srinagar with one single ticket from origin to destination. Now, railways will focus on the completion of the missing link of Banihal to Katra. There are 29 projects running in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana at an estimated cost of rupees 20,680 crore. I intend to hold coordination meetings with the officials of the newly created states and consider their requests so as to give necessary economic boost. on this issue concerning on the issues concerning railways in the twin states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, a committee has been already been set up of the railways and state government officials. Further action will be taken soon after the receipt of the report of the committee. With the challenges posed by the steadily increasing urban population in metros and in million plus cities, a holistic approach to urban transport is required. A smooth and seamless intermodal access is essential to improve urban mobility, and therefore passenger-centric focus will be given to urban transport infrastructure creation. We will coordinate with other transport ministries and urban bodies to develop optimal systems of integration of railways with other transport modes. Mumbai city will get 864 additional state-of-the-art EMUs over a period of 2 years, with completion of the conversion of traction from 1,500 volts DC to 25 kV AC in Mumbai suburban railways. The efficiency of operations would improve besides reducing the cost operations. Madam Speaker, as you are aware, Bangalore, with bustling business activity, attracts large commuters from surrounding rural areas and towns, necessitating better connectivity of Bangalore city with suburban areas and hinterland, a study to explore possibility of enhancing the existing Indian Railway network of Bangalore for meeting the above need will be taken up immediately. In addition to cater the demand of passenger traffic in Bangalore area, Bayyappanahalli will be developed as a coaching terminal. Online registration of demand of wagons will be launched in the next 2 months. This will facilitate online payment of wagon registration fee as well as registering demand for wagons. Further, a process for electronic railway receipt will also be initiated during the year. Indian Railways proposed to introduce tourism-free wagons with low tire weight for movement of salt. Dedicated. I am not completed. Dedicated freight corridor projects, implementation of dedicated. You hear me, I say. I am reading it, I am not completed.
Please.
Dedicated freight corridor project implementation of East. Dedicated freight corridor projects of implementation of Eastern and Western DFCs will be closely monitored. The World Bank loan agreement for Kanpur Mughal Sarai station of Eastern corridor of dedicated freight corridor will be signed by the current year. During 2014-15, award of nearly 1,000 km of civil construction contract is targeted. Ever since assuming the office, I have received innumerable requests for continuance of experimental stoppages from honorable ministers of parliament and various public representatives. I understand that large number of stoppages have been provided on experimental basis over a period of time. While I appreciate the wish of everyone wanting a stoppage close to their place of work or residence, there is a cost to the system for each stoppage. Also, too many stoppages results in slowing down of trains and increase the travel time, particularly long distance passengers. If this trend continues, most of our express trains will become passenger trains. I would like to inform this House that I have allowed continuation of these experimental stoppages for a further period of 3 months, that is up to 30th September 2014. Then these stoppages will be reviewed solely on the basis of operational feasibility and commercial justification. Demand for new stoppages hereinafter will also be considered on the same criteria. We will try to provide alternative train connectivity to meet the genuine demands of the public. Besides expansion and capacity augmentation projects, assessment of future needs of providing connectivity to hitherto unconnected regions need to be assessed. I have also been receiving requests for projects from the honorable members, state governments and other public representatives. To honor their request, I propose to undertake 18 surveys for new lines and 10 surveys for doubling and tripling and gauge conversion projects in 2014-15. The following is the list of such surveys. Surveys for new lines: Kanyangad Panathur Kaniur, Mughal Sarai Bahu Vaya Nawar, Hoshiapur Andura, Aurangabad Chalisgaon, Singroli Chavralal Lusa, Gabbur Bellari, Shumaga Shringeri Mangalore, Badavan Jagram Vaya Chandul, Talgupa Siddhapur, Babua Mundeshwari, Jind Hisur, Gadag Harpanali, Una Harimpur, Ujjain Jalwar Agar Sanser Soyat, Hisar Narwana, Solapur Tuljapur. Rail connectivity to Chardam, Kedarnath, Badarnath. Rail connectivity to iron ore mines between Nayagar and Banspani, Bashpani. Doubling of third and fourth lines and gauge conversion. Doubling of Jaipur Kota. Doubling of Channapore Nagbir. Doubling of Mangalore Ullal Suratkal. Doubling of Rewai Mahendragar. Busawal, Bundera, Wadra, third line. Kasara, Igatpuri, fourth line. Karzat, Lonwala, fourth line. Itarsi, Buswal, third line. Gauge conversion of meter gauge line in Ahmedabad up to Mahensa. Gauge conversion of Pilibhit, Shahjahanpur. Surveys for Sagar, Chatrapur, Khajuraho, Bhopal. Surveys for Sagar, Chatrapur, Khajuraho, Bhopal and Jabalpur, Udaipur new line have been completed. I will get them examined expeditiously. Survey for Indore, Jabalpur new line will be expedited. I am happy to announce that Mysore Kushalnagar portion of Mysore Kushalnagar Madikeri new line has been completed and the state government has agreed to share the cost of the project. This will provide railway connectivity to an important tourist destination in Kodagu district. I propose to pursue this project for obtaining requisite approvals after completion of the remaining survey. A survey for new line between Tarighat and Ghazipur has been completed. However, the same needs to be examined by extending survey up to Mau so as to connect the line to the railway network further. It will be undertaken expeditiously. New trains. I would like to inform the August House that while I have received innumerable requests from various quarters for running new train services, resource constraints preclude me from meeting many of them. Nonetheless, to meet the critical demands of unreserved and reserved segments, I have decided to run Janasadharan group of trains and premium group of trains respectively, including those announced in the interim budget 2014-15. These services would be meeting the demand spikes which manifest themselves on special occasions. Special trains would continue to run to meet the holiday and festival rush, including services for Melmaruvattur, Velankanni, Jalawar, etc., for which I have received special requests from the public representatives. I propose to introduce 5 Janasadharan trains and 5 premium trains, 6 AC express trains, 27 express trains, 8 passenger trains, 2 memu services and 5 demu services. Besides, I also propose to extend the run of 11 existing trains. The following is the list. Ahmedabad Darbhanga Janasadharan Express via Surat. Jayanagar Mumbai Janasadharan Express. Mumbai Gorakhpur Janasadharan Express. Saharasa Anand Vihar Janasadharan Express via Motihari. Saharasa Amritsar Janasadharan Express. Premium trains. Mumbai Central New Delhi Premium AC Express. Shalimar Chennai Premium AC Express. Sikandarabad Hazrat Nizamuddin Premium AC Express. Jaipur Madurai Premium Express. Kamakhya Bangalore Premium Express. AC Express trains. Vijayawada New Delhi AP Express. Lokman Tilak Lucknow Weekly. Nagpur Pune Weekly. Nagpur Amritsar Weekly. Nahargaon New Delhi Weekly. Nizamuddin Pune Weekly. Express trains. Ahmedabad Patna Express via Varanasi. Ahmedabad Chennai Express via Vasai Road. Bangalore Mangalore Express. Bandra Jaipur Express via Nagda and Bidar Mumbai Express. Chapra Lucknow Express via Balia. Chapra Lucknow Express via Balia, Ghazipur, Varanasi. Firozpur Chandigarh Express 6 days a week. Guwahati Nahargaon Intercity Express daily. Guwahati Murkong Select Intercity Express daily, Gorakhpur Anand Vihar Express weekly, Hapa Bilaspur Express weekly via Nagpur, Hazur Sahib Nanded BKNR Express weekly, Indore Jammu Tawi Express, Kamakhya Katra Express via Darbhanga, Kanpur Jamtavi Express bi-weekly, Lokmanya Tilak Ajampur Express weekly, Mumbai Kasipat Express via Ballarsha, Mumbai Patiala Express, New Delhi Batinda Shatabdi Express bi-weekly, New Delhi Varanasi Express daily, Paradip Howrah Express weekly, Paradip Vishakhapatnam weekly, Rajkot Rewa Express weekly, Ramnagar Agra Express weekly, Bangalore Shumaga Express bi-weekly, Tata Nagar Bayapanalli Express weekly, Vishakhapatnam Chennai Express weekly, Bikaner Revri Passenger daily, Darwad Dandeli via passenger via Alnavar, Gorakhpur Nautala Passenger daily, Gawat Mendatpur Passenger, Hatiyar Urkela Passenger, Bindur Kasargod Passenger daily, Rangpatara North Rangia Passenger daily, Yashovant Tumkur daily, Memu Services, Palwal Delhi Aligarh, Bangalore Ramnagara 6 days week, Demu Services, Chapra Mundrat via Balia, Bangalore Nelmangala, Baramulla Banihal, Sambalpur Rourkela 6 days a week, Shanpur Hosur 6 days a week. Extension of existing range, Anand Vihar Saram Garib Rath Express Gaya, Delhi Sarai Rohila, Srirangapur Express BKNR, Gondia Mujaffar Nagar Express to Barani, New Delhi Bolapur Shatabdi Express Harijgan, Lutia Nishapur Paris Sadalpur, Sonapur. By recalling the popular verses of D.V. Gundappa, a famous poet and writer of Kannada. Sandehevi Kritioli Nilna Vendalla, Indu Nambihude Mundendu Mendalla, Kundu Tordandadana Tiddikole Manasuntu, Indigi Matavuchita Mangutimma. This translates, 1 minute, it is not that after reading this book, there will be no more doubts. It is not what we believe today will be hold forever. If someone finds out some shortcoming, I have an open mind to correct. I have an open mind to correct. But now I believe this is right. With these words, Madam Speaker, I commend the Railways Budget for 2014-15 to this August House. Jai Hind.